Wish it did. That would be so cool. So, folks, hopefully we are online. Hopefully I clicked everything right. So if you can hear us, see us, then put that in the chat box. In fact, well, just say hello and let us know where you are joining us from. This is Avi in Seattle. Nikki, where are you based out of?
I'm based in Oschot near Eindhoven in the Netherlands.
All right, awesome. So, folks, yep. And we wanted to have Nikki as one of our speakers in the conference, but due to time conflicts, we kind of missed out on that. But this is awesome because this is just, kind of us and Nikki hanging out, and just we can just focus on this one thing and not be sandwiched between other sessions. So this is going to be awesome. We're going to have time for Q&A hopefully as well. So we're getting a lot of hellos here. And we got some Pia Hedder, Georgia, USA. Can see now, says Geeky from Norway. Awesome. Trevor is here from Charlotte. Experian from Texas. Dark Starry says hi from UK. And awesome. All right, so folks, and Eindhoven, the Netherlands, Chris van der Loot. So that is good to go. So let me introduce our speaker. So Nikki, what he's going to talk about is, so folks, either you have not planned, well, it's quite possible that you're already in the midst of a large-scale Power BI implementation, or maybe you're planning about one, thinking about it soon as it expands within your organization, or maybe you switch roles and you end up in a larger organization. But even if you're not in those two roles, I think this is something that's really kind of good to know, just so you know kind of what's on the horizon, what's in the front. So Nikki has worked with a group of, I think it was 750 plus folks. So a pretty large-scale Power BI implementation, and he is here to teach us the lessons, the tips and tricks, so that you can deploy Power BI on a large-scale basis without the large-scale headaches. So I'm going to turn over controls to Nikki. So Nikki, go ahead and let's see. You can start sharing your screen. I don't know if I need to do something on my side for that.
Yeah,
Maybe I do. Okay,
you're a
there we
presenter.
go.
Yeah.
Yep. And by the way, congratulations on becoming Microsoft MVP. How awesome is that, huh?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, just the latest news, indeed.
Yeah, that's
Yes.
terrific. Hey, great timing. So folks, yep, we're in the midst of some pretty esteemed company. There are really a small number of Microsoft MVPs, specifically kind of the Power BI, the data platform MVPs all over the world. So Nikki, yeah, just tell us more about yourself and let's just dive into your session. I'm gonna go on mute. I'll be writing down my questions. I'll be writing down some of the good questions that I see in the chat board, and we'll tackle them at the end. Are you good to go?
Can you confirm that you see my screen?
Yep. Yeah. So we see the slideshow, tips and tricks of large scale Power BI implementation. Yep.
Cool. Okay. So let's start with a little introduction about me, and also I would like to start with a little introduction about you. So if you look at the bottom of the screen. There's a short link, so bit.ly/talk-power-bi. It's case sensitive, so be aware of that. Then you end
Awesome.
up at a forum, and I would like to ask you three questions, three or four questions. If you fill in the questions, then they'll show up in this dashboard in a few seconds or minutes. So while you go to that URL and answer those questions, I will introduce myself and we'll come back right to this dashboard.
Yeah, hey, can you show that URL one more time? I'm just gonna Okay, got it. So case sensitive.
Oh, we are.
Perfect. So we're gonna put that in the chat as well.
Oh yeah, that's cool. It will be on screen in a few slides also, so it's easier if it's in the chat. Okay, so I'm Nicky van Vroenhoven. I'm lead expert of the data management team at Van Lanschot Kempen. That's a specialist bank in the Netherlands, so a wealth manager, not a commercial bank. I'm very active online also, on Twitter, on my blog. I try to blog at least once a month. From the beginning of this year, I also started to be Power BI super user, as they call it. And they are the moderators of the community forum of Power BI. I also started together with Mark Lelyveld, the Dutch chapter of the Power BI Days. So it's a monthly meetups of on topics of Power BI, Power Platform. And as Avi already said, I got this great email today that I became a data platform MVP. So that's great news. So let's head over. Oh, I even got the old picture here. That's not a problem. Let's head over to my dashboard. If you want to see how I set up this this form and use Power Automate to get the answers into a Power BI streaming dataset, you can check out my blog. It's detailed there in steps, so you can see how I did that. So let's have a look. If anybody already tried the link. Yet we can come back at it later.
That's not a problem. Hey, Nikki, yeah, so folks, go to the link and take that poll. So that's going to be fun. And so, Nikki, your mic is kind of going in and out a little bit. So I don't know if it's kind of positioning or sometimes the new ones have audio cancellation and they start kicking in. But yeah, maybe just be a little bit louder. Maybe that'll help things. Or if it's a positional mic, then you know if you can be a scoot a little bit closer, that'll be good.
Yeah, I will do that.
Awesome. Yeah, it's definitely working. Yeah, and folks, yeah, go ahead and click on that link.
Just give it a few seconds then.
Yeah, the YouTube crowd is a little bit, they lag behind sometimes a few minutes. So yeah, let's come back to that.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's no problem. We'll come back to it in a few minutes. So today we're going to talk about well, the implementation of Power BI at our company, so Frans van Kempen. So a little bit about Frans van Kempen, what kind of organization is it, and what does the data management team do? But then we're going to dive into how we implemented Power BI, what things we ran into. We're also using Premium, of course, because we have such a number of pro licenses. That's why we switched to Premium. And well, on the way, we will see our journey that we took, and also some tips and tricks and lessons learned, and also things on the roadmap for us to do. So let's start with the company itself, Van Lanschot Kempen. So as I said, it's a Dutch specialist bank, wealth manager, with three brands actually. So Van Lanschot is the oldest.
So Nikki, sorry, man, sorry to interrupt you, but yeah, the audio, I think, is still problematic. So either you have to be really close to the mic or speak really loud. Maybe imagine yourself on a stage without a mic. and yeah, so I'm not sure why it's doing that. But yeah, let's try one of those things, see how that goes. So yeah, really loud or really close to the mic, or maybe both even.
All right. Yeah, 1 second. I might be able to... using the right one.
Yeah, it almost.
Let me see.
Okay, that sounds a lot better.
Okay, yeah, then it was on my headset, I think, and now it's switched to my laptop, so that should be better.
Yep, that sounded a lot better. All right, let's go.
Okay, great. I will leave it at this one. Okay, so Van Lanschot focused at the private bank. Then we have Kempen, that's the Dutch merchant bank, so focused at corporate finance and asset management, for example, for pension funds and financial institutions. And the last one is AV, that is the youngest member and has a lower entry level and also only online. So let's look at some numbers. Maybe there are more people working at financial institutes. We last year we had client assets of 100 billion euros, And we have a common equity tier one ratio of almost 24%. The minimum is 4.5%, so that says something about your solvability of the bank. So that's pretty good, I would say. Now onto our data management team. Our BI organization is set up as a tree with the roots into the operational systems. So the server-centered data management, my department is at the center, and we make sure that all the data from the source.
Hey, Nikki, sorry, man, I keep interrupting. But
Yeah.
yeah, it was fine for a bit, and I don't know what's going on yet. Yeah, you're cutting in and out, and I
That's not good.
can't tell
Let
what's
me
going
try
on at
again.
your end. Is it the position of the camera at all? So either it's a noise canceling, but usually it's on the
No,
headset, I was
that's.
hoping, right? Or maybe it's so sensitive that as you're rocking back and forth, and you obviously do, right? I mean, we kind of move as we present, so
Yeah.
the voice is kind of, it comes in, we hear you loud and clear, and then it goes and fades away. Yeah, and again, maybe imagine yourself in a stage standard without a mic, and right, so
Yeah.
yeah,
Okay. Well, I will try
let's
that.
okay.
It should be good, but I will try that, and let me know if you encounter any problems. Okay. So the server-centered data management where I work at is focused at the corporate data warehouse. So getting the data of all the source systems into the data warehouse every day, and then we have specific business analysts at the old departments that use the data from the data warehouse and also other sources maybe to create the reports needed in the business. So we have a sales management department and also a finance and risk department that has this specialist BI teams. And if you look at the structure of our data warehouse, it's a typical data warehouse with a staging layer, a data warehouse, and then data marts on top of that. For the source data, we have all kinds of systems and source data also. So we have databases, but also Excel files, CSV files that we transform in this layer into a common data model that is used in our data warehouse. And after that, we are using data marts and extraction marts to deliver the data to the business, but also to external parties. For example, the European Central Bank and the Dutch National Bank also have reports that we need to deliver every month. And we mainly use Power BI, but we also have some reporting services reports, so paginated reports, and sometimes also Excel or CSV or XML files to external parties, depending on the needs of the systems. And the last part is our analytics department that does more on data science things on the raw data. So not particularly on the data warehouse data, but on the raw data that is coming from the source systems. So this is the timeline and that we used in our company. We began with an organic growth of Power BI. So we used a little department that was already tech savvy, and that did we use to start with the Power BI in the beginning of 2016. Before that, we actually used the Power Pivot tools, so Power Pivot and Power Map, that later became Power BI. And this timeline will act as a guideline through this presentation. But before we continue, I'd like to first point out a few general things and issues we encountered. And what, yeah, a few of them were well, they involve the fact that we are a bank. So we are a financial institute. So we had a lot of challenges because of regulatory requirements. Mm-hmm. We have also GDPR and AVG then, in the Netherlands. So we have sensitive data, financial data, but also customer data. So we have to adhere to these privacy laws. And we have a regulatory reporting that we have to do to the national and also European supervisors. So that's both important points to take into account. And next to external struggles and things to take care of, we also have internal struggles, and that mainly handles the IT versus the business challenge. Because we had, well, IT regularly has the need for structure and repeatability, while the business wants to have freedom to create the reports and have this self-service BI. And IT would rather have a corporate BI. So everything is managed through IT, but then the agility for the business would be less. So the first thing between IT and business is, trust in each other, and it goes in two ways, because the business has to have trust in the data, and we try to create that with our data warehouse, so we have the one single version of the truth. But we also need to have trust in the business, so to give them the responsibility for creating their reports and for doing that self-service BI. With giving them the freedom, we can also afterwards start to monitor and see if they still agree and hold up to our appointments. So, for example, we have a naming convention for workspaces set up, and a few people of those specialist BI teams can create the reports, and afterwards we can check if those workspaces are using the naming conventions, and also if there are any inactive workspaces, for example. So they can still create workspaces, but if they are not used for, let's say, 30 days, then we can well, first ask the users why they created them, if they are still going to use them, and then we can clean them up afterwards. So let's first look at a few examples of how we use Power BI in our business. As I said, trust is key, and we use this, or we accomplish this actually by using data quality in our data warehouse. So we have around 1,100 data quality rules set up, ranging from mandatory fields in source systems, for example, a passport number that has to be present, or an IBAN number by regarding an account for a customer, that sort of things, but also more advanced data quality rules. And they are set up per source system, sometimes per destination system, and the solving department that has to solve the data quality hits, so that the issues that come up, they can look at this report and dashboard to see how many hits are generated each day and how many they still need to solve. And they also have different priorities, so they can check the top priorities that they need to solve. Another report is this one that's used by the fraud and money laundering department. So this actually generates a list of suspicious cases throughout our source systems. So all the data in our data warehouse from source systems is analyzed. And a machine learning algorithm analyzes those transactions and looks for suspicious cases. And all those cases come up in this report. And the department will investigate all those cases. And they can give feedback on every case. So in the bottom right corner, you see an integration of Power Apps where they can give feedback on this case. And they can say it's suspicious or not suspicious. And that will be written back to the database that is behind this report. And when they, for example, say that case one is not suspicious, then next time the model runs, this case will not be taken into account. So it could be false positive, for example. And that will be taken into the model again. So that's one form of integrating Power Apps into our Power BI reports. And the last example I would like to show is for AV. So here we also see a different look and feel because it's a different brand. And this is the course of the risk profiles for AV for the last years. Okay, let's go back to our timeline again. As I said, we started with organic growth. So with a few people in one department, we started with sharing reports as files, so Power BI files. Quickly after that, we started using the personal workspaces. And we also started with a Power BI focus group where we started to share experiences for departments that were using Power BI. We would start to share experiences around projects and things that went well or not so well, and just to learn from each other. And the reason why we started small was because there was no support for a big investment that time or a very long project. So we needed to start small, create some quick wins, and then show the business what Power BI could do and what it could do for them also. So we had to later get support from management. Let's start at a few of those workspaces that we started to use. The first things you see if you open a report is that you can share things pretty easily. But the thing is, if you use those share buttons in reports or dashboards, for example, then they end up at the Shared with Me tab in Power BI. And if you don't uncheck this button, then the people that you share it with can also reshare it with other people. So you end up with having no side at permissions or people that have access to those dashboards. So the first thing we did is teach people to use workspaces and share them from there. Later on, we also started using apps on workspaces, and we will see some examples from that later and how we use those. Because we are a pretty strict company, and we have certain rules around software and IT deliver of software. So our IT department packages software that we use on our laptops, and that's also the case with Power BI Desktop. And we set up a process with the monthly updates for Power BI Desktop, that whenever a blog post came out on the Power BI blog, then IT started to package Power BI. We ran some tests that we made sure that the reports still were running, nothing strange would happen, and then we would make the new desktop available for everyone so they could update it. And we also used OneDrive for versioning the Power BI files, and we still do that. Because there's, for us right now, no better option for version control. There are some options coming, like a tablet editor and the XML read write endpoints, but we haven't implemented that yet. So for now, we're still just using a OneDrive for versioning the Power BI files. That works pretty good. And you can also couple a OneDrive to a workspace. So that works pretty good. If we then move a little bit forward to the beginning of 2017, we started to use workspaces more and more, and also use the app workspaces that were introduced. We also started to use the templates in Power BI. So we had a JSON file with, that we could use with our colors, for example, for our different brands. If you look at how that difference will show, this is for Van Lanschot Kempen, brands of the corporate brand. If you then look for Kempen, it's just another color palette and some other banners. That you immediately see for which brand the report is meant to be. And next to that, we also have a set of custom branding in the service. It's something you can set up in the admin portal of Power BI. So you can set up a few things, actually. You have the logo, the cover image, and also the bar, so the theme color. And that also works on your mobile. So that's pretty good to have that the colors of your own company to show up in the reports. Makes it a little bit more feeling of your company. And as I mentioned, we also started using workspaces and apps. So if we look at the way we like to do that, is we create our models in Power BI Desktop, and then we publish to a workspace or an app workspace. And after that, we publish to an app. So that means that our workspace actually becomes our staging or development environment, what you like to call it. And the app is then the way for the end users to consume the content. So that will be the production stage. So it's clear for end users, they always need to use the app. And because we use the naming convention, they can easily find their apps in the department slash team name. The biggest advantage for us was with apps, you don't need to pro license if the workspace isn't premium. So I will we will come back to that later, what that means for our pricing model. And as I mentioned, apps. I will for a second go back to the dashboard. So we have some answers that are coming in now. That's good. So we have.
Wow, that's pretty cool. So that's live, folks. So anybody who kind of entered in, I see my name there, Avi. That's good. Man, this is really curious. Are you going to maybe just tell us a little bit later on about the back end of this? I mean, I'm guessing some Power Apps and Power BI magic involved.
Yeah, I can I can tell you right now, real quick. As I mentioned, it's explained in detail in on my blog.
Okay.
You can find it there, but I can show you real quick over here. So what I did is create probably a streaming data set. I created a form and with Flow. With Flow, I created a Power Automate. I created a flow that get those values from the forms into my streaming data set. Let me open up this one. So you get your response from forms.
Yeah.
And you add your rows to a streaming data set, and it's just as easy as clicking through the fields. So this is the first name. This is your continent. It's just a click and go. You don't have to code anything, so that's really good.
Pretty cool.
And afterwards, you create your report, and finally your dashboard. And the dashboard, that you see one answer coming in.
Nice.
So then the dashboard creates a live view, and that makes sure that it updates live also.
Yeah. So you can only connect to a streaming data set when you're on the service, PowerBI.com, right? You can't tell Power BI Desktop to do it. Am I right?
Yeah, you can, because I created this in PowerBI Desktop.
Oh, okay. All right.
It's actually
Just something I
it's
didn't
created
know.
here.
Nice. Pretty
Yeah.
cool.
So
Awesome.
if you look over here, then you see that it's live connected to the streaming data set. And obviously I have to refresh here, but if I now refresh, then I would have the same data
Yeah.
in here as I would have online.
That's great.
So there
Thanks.
we are. Thanks for now. Let's for a second also look at the data. So we have mostly PowerBI Desktop, that's of course logical. And a few also PowerBI Premium, okay. And let's say more than half is around or even more than 1 year. So that's 60%, almost 70% more than 1 year. Okay. That's good. What I actually wanted to show you also was how you can set up an app in a workspace. So this is a demo workspace that I use for training and workshops in our company. The app is called Dashboard in a Day. So that's Microsoft content that you can use to give training and the workshop to your employees. It's mostly used by partners to give trainings to customers, but we use it in our company also. And we see over here that it says what should be included in the app. So you can, for example, exclude those two and only have this one included in the app. So you can create an app, give it a name, give it a useful summary. You can set a support side if you want. So direct people that use this app to a SharePoint site, for example. Also use this the other things. You can set a navigation. If you have multiple reports, you can set a navigation that might be different than the report pages itself. And you can also do some cool things in here. If you want, you can even embed a PowerPoint or web pages in here. So you can use the content area to, for example, use a OneDrive link for a PowerPoint and have that embedded in the app. Let's remove this and then we check permissions. And here we use the, you can use users or Azure directory groups. So that's what we use Azure directory groups to distribute the content to the users. Now I will use my other account just to show that we can share the app. You might want to have a look at the settings over here. I always check this. This will automatically install the app so that it comes up in the apps part right away. People don't have to install it. This will give the user, as it says, access to the underlying data sets. So it might be necessary, but just make sure that you take a note of this. If you publish this, and then I'll go to the app with my other user, and here we have it already. So SCTM Dashboard in a Day. So now we are at apps and not at the workspace itself. So I only have read-only access to the content in there. And these are just the pages of the report that we also would see in the workspace. So the content is the same, but now it's shared through an app, and we only have read-only access. Yeah, I will also show you later how we use those Azure directory groups to distribute the content in a safe manner. So one more thing I should mention, the relationship between workspace and apps is one-on-one. So you can create one app per workspace, and that's not likely to be changed in the near future. So if you want to distribute content to a different group of people or different people, then you would have to create another workspace. For example, if you have a sales department and sales management, or a management team of the sales department, then you have to create two workspaces and two apps for that. As I said, we had quite some users. I think in the beginning of 2018, we had around 750 co-licenses. So that was a good time to switch to premium. Mm-hmm. And well, using Power BI Premium can have, well, yeah, you can have two ways to look at it. Firstly, it can be a cost benefit. So roughly around 500 users, there is a tipping point. If you have more than 500 users, then Power BI Premium is an advantage for you, because then you will you can use the free license together with the app published in the workspace. But that's mostly to management. And we as the developers, as a and as the end users also, we also look at the features of Power BI that we can use. So
Power
features
BI
that come
apps
up with the Power BI Premium.
Used to distribute
mainly for us, the things that we used, the refreshes that we had per day, so 48 refreshes in Premium, and also big data sets. So with shared capacity, so Power BI Pro, you only have 1 gigabyte. That's for a Power BI model. But with Power BI Premium, you can reach up to 10 gigabytes per data model, so per Power BI Excel. And there are a few data sets that that use around two, three, or four gigabytes. So we do use that as feature. Well, the licensing part was, of course, the most important one, starting with Premium. But now there are also the XML endpoint that is that has become available in preview, the read write. That is, and also I think a month ago the deployment pipelines started coming in preview, and that's something to that we are really looking into. I will have to show you that in a little bit. Deployment pipelines are actually your development, test, and production in a covered in the workspace. So that's a pretty good start of using using those features. Data flows, the linked and computed entities is also a premium feature. We're not using data flows that much, I would say, and also the AI features were we're not using those. So that's just it's nice to have, but we are not not using that right now. So if you have premium capacity, it's like you get a CPU and memory, and you have to manage it yourself. So with that comes the premium capacity metrics app that is shown here. I will shortly go to here. Let's open it up. The main problem for us is, or for anyone, I think, is that this app only shows 7 days of data. And if you want more, then you have to get it yourself from the REST API or the analytics API, or the log analytics API. So out of the box, you can use this app. Let's make it a little bigger. And you can see all kinds of things. So let's first look at the first page. You have a health center that you can use. You can choose your capacity if you have multiple. And you have some metrics shown here. So if they're not crossing the threshold, then you're mostly pretty good. You can show the different things. So data sets, paginated reports, data flows, all the things that you enabled in your on your capacity. So you can give all those features a dedicated set of memory if you want to use them. If you don't want to use them, you can just turn them off. For example, you could turn off data flows or business reports if you don't use them. And per data set and per workspace, you can see the number of refreshes and the reliability of the refreshes also. So if you look at this time, it's 7 a.m. UTC, so that's 9 a.m. from 8 to 9 at our time. So that's a pretty busy time, as you see, that for all the refreshes taking place. And what we could do is move some of those refreshes earlier or later to have the capacity, to give the capacity a little bit of room, for example. But as you see, it's not at the max of its capacity. We have P1, yeah, so it's 25 gigabytes of RAM, but not hitting the maximum here. So it's not that big of a problem. But over here, you do see one data set that's taking quite a lot of time. So you might want to check that and see what's happening, if it's a problem or that's just at one refresh that was taking too long, for example. So next to the refreshes, you can also have a look at the query durations or the query rates to see if queries on the reports are slow or are taking a long time, for example. Over here, we see one report that's pretty large on around 100 seconds on duration, but it's worth to take a look at. And last, you can see the CPU and the memory consumption also. The CPU is mostly a report and the users interacting with the reports. If you have many measures, for example, or many visuals, that would eat up CPU. And memory is mostly data sets or refreshes that are taking place. So, for that premium capacity, as I said, in the beginning of last year, we started with around 750 pro licenses, and we switched to premium with this P1 license for premium. So that's the smallest model that you have, and we switched to back to 80 pro licenses. Gradually grew in the coming months to I think 100 or 120, but we did cut it back quite far. As I said, when we started using premium, we also started to professionalize the governance and administration of Power BI a little bit more. And for the first thing, we started to use auditing of the security and permissions of our identity management system. So whenever we create a workspace, we always created three groups. So admins, members, and viewers. That's the name we give the Azure directory groups. And then the admins and members were of the workspace were taken to that respective group, and the viewers were our end users that are using the app. So if you look at an example, for example, here for a second. So if you look at this one, so the data warehouse workspace, that's the workspace for our department actually. You look at the access. Actually some regular users in there, so they should be replaced to use the AD groups. If I just show you, let's look at the AD groups. So for this SCDM data warehouse group, we use the workspace name as the name of the group also. And then we have, like I said, the admins, members, and the viewers. And as you can see, the admins are the admin and members, the member. So that's obvious. And then if you look at the published app that we have on this workspace, you see the viewers group is used in the permission of the app. So that makes those three Azure Active Directory groups used in our workspaces. And sometimes instead of using the published app, we also give the viewer a role to the to this AD group. So for example, if you look at over here, we also, what we could do is give those viewers, instead of giving access to the app, we could give them viewer rights to the workspace also. That's also read-only access, but then you can see all the content in the workspace. So that's the difference between using the app and using the viewer role of the workspace. So you can include things in the app, but if you have the viewer role of the workspace, then you can see the whole content of the app, no matter what's included in that, or the whole content of the workspace, I should say. Getting it mixed up. Okay. And as I said, we also had to trust the business. So we had some Power BI super users from those specialist BI teams that could create workspaces. And they have a workflow also set up for that for via our ticketing system. So whenever they wanted to create an app workspace, they have to fill out the form to mention if they need it in premium or not, depending on the number of end users they need. And following a naming convention, we will create those three groups and distribute it, the users used in that group to access the workspace. And when needed, the members and admins also were assigned the pro license automatically. So that's something you have to account for in the workflow. And those were separate workflows that were executed after that. So one workflow to create a workspace, one workflow to create the AD groups, and another one to give the users access to that groups. Another thing that we did is setting in the Power BI admin portal is you can use the personalized help button to redirect users to your own SharePoint or ticketing system, depending on your needs. So you have a few options to do that. For example, you can send them the training documentation. We also have a discussion forum where people can send in questions and our super users will try to answer them. I recommend to use the community .powerbi.com, but sometimes it's sensitive data, for example, or just a very specific question that a few of our colleagues would know, then we can use this internal discussion forum. And also licensing requests, they can go right to the workflow of getting a pro license at our ticketing system. It would, that's the fastest way to get it approved. Okay, I already shared some tips and tricks during the presentation. I would like to go over some lessons that we learned also. The first thing is that knowledge for the key users, but also the end users is key. So that means we did Power BI that's within a day and that's within an hour workshops. They were given to small teams of a department, for example. And those teams then transfer that knowledge back to their colleagues also. So it's the trainer principle, so that they could spread that knowledge in their department themselves. We started the focus group in after the a few months of starting the Power BI. And the first thing we did is have a meeting once a month, for example, with different content in that meeting. So ranging from sharing projects to technical content and having diverse content and also diverse diverse attendees was not the best thing we noticed. So what we ended up is using two tracks. So an end user track where we shared experiences and shared new features that were coming out in Power BI Desktop, for example. And we also had a more advanced and technical and in-depth track where we used, for example, a row versus filter context or explained some DAX functions to the BI specialists, so to the technical people. But that was a clear understanding of what track people could sign up to. As I mentioned, we started with a P1 premium capacity, but we fairly fast grew out of that capacity because we had a few reports for the private bank, so for our business bankers that were pretty large. That were those 3 and 4 gigabyte data sets, and those were using a lot of memory in that premium capacity, but also were the reports that were used the most by the users. So that's why we ended up buying an additional P2, so next to that P1, and have that dedicated to those computation heavy and well, mostly used dashboards. And in the beginning of this year, so 3 months back, I would say, we upgraded that P2 even to P3. So that's 400 gigabytes of RAM. And now it seems to stabilize a little bit more, so that's good. There were some discussions around, optimizing data models, for example. But the choice was made just to upgrade to P3 now and see what we can do in the rest of the year to optimize the data models some more, monitor the performance of the workspace. So there was just a need to upgrade the performance right away. So that was the choice to be made. I would say monitoring performance is an important thing, especially optimizing your data models, make a star schema, for example, that performs much better than having don't having a star schema. For this workspace and heavily used dashboards, we just didn't have the time right now. So that's a choice made by the business, and they wanted to get a P3. So that's what we did. Okay, this is one of the last slides. A few things that we also did. We have some best practices around Power BI for different topics. So Power Query, data model. And we used the Power BI cheat sheet for that. It's well known. And as I said, we used naming conventions not only for workspaces, but also for creating gateway data sources. It's something I manage also, and it's not the best interface right now. And that's why we set up those naming conventions. So we use a type server and database to, and now even the username of the account that we use, so that we can check back what database and what account are used together, for example. are some ways to and ideas to improve those user interface for the gateway data store. But I think over a year ago that they were working on that, but I haven't seen anything. So I'm wondering when they will end up implementing it. Well, another thing is monitoring your premium capacity. It's certainly important because it's your own capacity and you have to manage it yourself in the ways that you can. And the last thing I'd like to mention is one thing we do often, we also sometimes use analysis service cubes for connecting to our data. So we only have a data, the data model is stored in analysis service, and we only have to visualize the reports in Power BI Desktop. But what you can also do is disconnect your data set from your report. Now, it works is that you publish your Power BI Desktop model to the to an workspace, to the servers, and then connect from your Power BI Desktop to that workspace with a live connection. And then you can, for example, let the self-service users create a report and have the more technical specialist BI teams manage the data model, so that you get a separation of the data model and the report. And this also can be used as a shared data set, so that you can publish the data model to workspace A, for example, and develop the reports in the workspace B, C, or other workspaces. So you get a real separation of duties also. So we did quite some things, but we're not at the end, I think. So we have some things on our roadmap. And for example, a few things that I'm working right now is, for example, refreshing a data set with PowerShell and a service principle. Because the refreshing of Power BI is now time-based. So you set it on a schedule every day or every hour. And as we refresh our data warehouse, our Power BI data sets need to be refreshed after that. So we would like to have it event-based. So whenever our database is refreshed, then we would like to have our data set also refreshed. So that's something we can set up with PowerShell. So we can have a step in our SQL agent job, for example, to execute that refresh of the data set. And I would say we are around 80% there. I managed to get it working on my own laptop. So refreshing a data set in PowerShell with a service principle. We just have to make it secure using Azure Key Vault, for example, to get a secret of the service principle. So we don't need to enter any sensitive data in the job steps. So that's one step to be taken. And some other things we would like to do is migrate all the workspaces to the new workspace or the now default, as it's called, because that will no longer create an Office 365 group if you create a new workspace. And even later this year, they are also decoupling Teams and creating a Power BI workspace. But that's good. Then we will only have to worry about workspaces in Power BI and not about Teams workspaces, for example. Mm. As I said, the premium metrics app is it's a good out of the box way to monitor your basic premium capacity, but it's only 7 days, for example, and there's only so much you can monitor. So we would like to have more long-term logging, and also set up some monitoring that we would like to have ourselves. And while this was mostly well, tips and tricks on Power BI, we are also using all the features of the Power Platform, so mainly Power Apps and Power Automate. And there is also some governance administration that that comes to that. So, for example, with Power Apps and Power Automate, you have a different data source connections in your gateway. So you can have the same gateway server, but you need different connections in those platforms. So different than in Power BI. And you also have environments there. So you can set up a, you have the default environment, and you can set up test and development environments, for example, that you don't have in that way in Power BI. So it all works a little bit different, and we're just trying to figure out how that would work the best for us. And there's one thing. We previously would like to have development pipeline, for example, have a dev test and prod workspace and use PowerShell to copy the content from one workspace to another. But now deployment pipelines have come into play. And we're starting to use that and see how we can leverage that to get Power BI reports and dashboards and data sets. Better from dev to test to production. I thought I had a slide in here about. Let me check for a second. There it is. Yeah. So these are deployment pipelines. It's still in preview, but you can set it up for a workspace. Then you can have. You can actually have three workspaces, so one in development, one in test, and one in production, and you can move the content between those workspaces. And you can also see the difference between the workspaces. So if there's been a change in one of the reports, and you see that there's a change between test and production. So you can see what artifacts have changed, not exactly what has changed inside. That's not visible here. But then if everything is tested and end users or testers, for example, have acknowledged the changes, then you can deploy to production and set the content from test to production. So that's a nice way of handling that. I would. From these resources, they're all links. You can check them later in the slides when they are available. I would like to point out the white papers that we used, for example, the deployment and managing Power BI enterprise deployment, the planning of Power BI enterprise deployment. Just recently, an update of that white paper came out. It's by Melissa Coates. And a few others. It's a really good white paper. So if you're looking into enterprise-wide deployment, not specifically premium, but just Power BI Enterprise, then I'll definitely have a look at that white paper. And with that, I would like to thank you and say let's connect. And if you have any questions, then let me know, Avi.
All right, absolutely. Hey, I just want to make sure I know it's late in your neck of the woods, so it's already late for you. And are you going to be able to stay back for a bit of questions, Q&A?
Yeah, that's no problem. I'll be around for 5, 10 minutes, 15. What's necessary? Yeah.
Awesome. So let me kick it off. So I wrote down some of the folks will be asking. So Experian. Oh, hold on. Let's get the. Webcam on as well. So Experian was asking, and you touched on this a little bit, but if you can speak a little bit more about that. Basically, what he was asking, what is the advantage of apps compared to workspaces V2 with premium capacity? So we have workspace versus apps. What's your take on that?
Especially if you use premium, then the biggest advantage of using an app is that you don't need a pro license for the users viewing the app. So let me get this one up.
Okay. So if you use Workspace, even if the Workspace has been assigned to premium capacity, and even if we add people as viewers to the Workspace, they would still need a pro license?
No, as viewers, not. That's the only one that you don't need a pro license. That's correct. So the viewer role that was introduced a few months ago, or maybe 6 months already.
All right.
That's the only one that doesn't use a pro license. And before that, the viewer role was available. We used the apps. And that was the only way to ensure that you don't need a pro license when the Workspace is in premium capacity. But any of the other roles, so contributor, member, or admin, do need a pro license, even if it's in premium capacity.
Got it. All right.
Yeah. All right.
That makes sense. And there were some questions and discussion around this challenge of having multiple Power BI developers. Of course, starting out, there's one person that's like, oh, this is my PBIX file. But of course, as you go beyond that, it's no longer the case. It's a company's PBIX file, and there are multiple authors, maybe even for across different teams, or maybe even in the same team. And that's always been challenging. What's been the best way that you guys have handled that? That you do need multiple people to be able to edit the same PBIX file. How have you handled that at your organization?
As I said, we use OneDrive for versioning. Mm-hmm. So versioning the PBIX files, and that's also the way we use multiple developers on the same Power BI file. So, for example, you can.
But with that, can two people by accident not still open the file at the same time and then?
Yeah, that's true. You can still do that. Yeah.
So
you have an option. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have an option in SharePoint to make people check out all files. So if you want to edit a file, then you have to check it out, and then it's exclusively checked out to that person. That's an option, but then you have to save it and then check it in again. If you forget that, then it stays checked out. So that is an option to make sure only one person can edit it at the same time.
Okay, great. And Geeky here is asking a question. I think you addressed that, but maybe you can touch on that. So Geeky is asking, can you easily add a group of people to a workspace without having to add individuals one by one?
Yeah, certainly, because that's what we also do. So this, the SCDM Data Warehouse Admins, is an AD group where multiple people can be employed to. So that's the way we use groups, and that's also the case in the app permissions list.
Perfect.
So if you look over here in the permissions, well, these are regular users, but this one is also an AD group.
Got it. And I think you had a trio of these, right? The viewers, members, administrators.
Members and admins, yeah,
perfect.
Correct.
So you set up three user groups for every workspace, and that's how it works. Now, about this, you talked something about workflow automation, where you said the workspaces are set up and pro licenses assigned. I was wondering, like, pro license assignment, it sounded like it is automated. Is it automated? How do you automate that? Is it shells, PowerShell scripting or something else?
Yeah, you could totally automate it, but at our company, it's partly automated, I would say. It's if you fill in the request, then first one of the Power BI administrators has to approve it. It just looks over the request if everything is filled out correctly, then it will be approved, and then three separate workflow activities are started. As I said, one for creating the workspace, but that's all manual steps.
Okay.
So the workflow is executed, and it's connected to one of the persons that has to execute it.
Terrific. And what is the workflow managed in? Like, what's the tool?
It's Topdesk. So it's a ticketing, an incident management system.
Perfect. That makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. And you talked about upgrading from P1 to P2 to P3, and that's just based on usage data. I mean, you monitor, you show the reports, and you say, "Oh man, it's kind of hitting those thresholds at the peak usage hours. It's the response time is longer, something like that." Is it purely based on the usage data, the reports that you showed?
Yeah, correct. And the problem with those big data sets, around 3 or 4 gigabytes, was they were used by hundreds of people through the day, so they were requested a lot. And even when refreshing, you need to double the memory. So if you refresh a data set of 4 gigabytes, it has to be refreshed in memory first, and then it gets swapped out. So you need that extra 4 gigabyte also.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I guess it was required or needed or desired, at least, that the data be refreshed multiple times a day. So you couldn't just do it middle of the night and then say it's done, right? I mean,
No, the refreshing was actually done once a day, I believe, because it's based on our data warehouse. So yeah, our data warehouse was only refreshed once a day. So
okay.
But especially when people started to query the reports, and they also wanted to export some things to PDF, for example, and it was a very computational heavy exercise.
Yeah, I think even with PowerBI.com, they rolled it out very, very kind of gradually. Cool. So something else, you talked about the training and retraining, and I love, and I've seen a lot of organizations kind of go that route where they define that, yep, these are kind of who need kind of the basics. These are the ones who are the model authors. They need more in-depth. They need to understand DAX, M, and so forth. But another element that I've almost always seen is also kind of a user community. And sometimes it's just online through whatever, Slack, Teams, or something else. Or often they have like a meetup once a month as well. So I'm wondering, how is that like at your organization?
We used to have the BI focus group, as I mentioned, with those end user track and in depth track. I have to say it hasn't started since Corona kicked in. So
yeah.
It hasn't started this year.
Okay.
But yeah, we do have. You always have different users in your company. Some that use the training and then don't look at it for a few weeks or months even.
Yeah.
And some people just want to get ahead and want to play with Power BI and also with are familiar with Excel, for example. So they are already a little bit more tech savvy than other people. And sometimes you see that users come back with questions that you that you hadn't trained them on. So they were experiencing things on themselves and developing reports that that are quite complex and pretty nice. And then they come back with this DAX question on time intelligence, for example, or how to use bookmarks or page navigation, that sort of thing. So that's good to see that they are developing content and knowledge on their own.
That's great. All right, so one last question before we let you go. I identify myself as a Power BI model author. That's what I love doing. And I understand, obviously, the importance of the administration stuff and all that stuff, but I have very little interest there. So I'm wondering, kind of for you personally, what have you experienced? I mean, it seems you have extensive knowledge on both sides, right? I mean, kind of in-depth Power BI knowledge, also the administration stuff. So has that been felt like a good balance for you, or have you felt pulled more in one direction than the other? I mean, is it a challenge sometimes kind of trying to do both of those roles?
I would say that the most part of my job is about administration and governance. Because our specialist BI teams are are mostly creating the reports and dashboard, and sometimes for a particular department or subject, the question comes to me. For example, now we're trying to get some information out of a source system with an API.
Mm-hmm.
So we had some issues with getting a token and user login and that sort of thing. So that was quite nice to figure out how it works. But I would say 80% of my time goes to administration, governance, and also with Power Apps and Automate. We have quite some things to sort out.
Awesome. All right.
Yeah.
That's great. Thanks for sharing all the content and thanks for answering all the Q&A, staying late for that. Hey, why don't you switch back to the last slide that you had with your contact information, and I will put it in the chat box as well. Yes. So folks, I'm going to post his LinkedIn in the chat box, but of course you have the, check out his blog, nikkivv.com, and you can follow him on Twitter as well. Nikki, thanks so much for your time. And man, I mean, that was a really interesting perspective. Clearly, you have led your organization to a pretty amazing journey. And it was apparent that you have experienced some of the bumps in the road and learned the lessons the hard way. It's so kind and generous of you to kind of share that with the group. Hopefully others can avoid those bumpy roads as they scale out Power BI. All right. Thank you so much, Nikki. Take care.
Okay, take care. Bye.